Welcome to the fifth and final webinar in this series in conjunction with GoAbroad.com and Premier TEFL. You'll know me as Premier TEFL's Managing Director, Rosie Mansfield, and today we're bringing you expert advice about how to teach English online. And I'm delighted to be joined again by some of my favourite alumni and expert teachers, Vanessa and Melissa. So let's kick off, ladies. Why don't you guys introduce yourself? Mel, why don't you go first? And you can talk a little bit about your background, your road to TEFL, your expertise, and introduce yourselves to the folks at home.
Thanks very much, Rosie. My name's Melissa, and my journey started off when I wanted to travel after my studies. I decided I was going to go to America for 2 years. I wish I could have traveled a little bit more there, but unfortunately, visa change of plans. So I decided that I wanted to go to Thailand. Premier TEFL landed up on my webpage, and I decided that I needed to do a 120-hour course, which was the minimum to go and teach there. I have my teaching degree as well, which was very beneficial to go and teach there, and I had experience. So Premier TEFL, I finished the course in about 3 weeks. It was absolutely amazing, very easy to navigate as well. And once I arrived there 2 weeks after I left America, Premier TEFL decided they wanted to follow me there and meet up with me. And that was absolutely amazing. I mean, what kind of company kind of goes and follows you just to make sure that you've traveled there safely? They even took us out for dinner. That was absolutely amazing as well. After Thailand, I stayed there for about 6 months. I came back to South Africa and I thought, well, let me settle down and find a place and get my teaching career on the go. I decided to teach in South Africa for 2 years here. And thought, no, this is not what I want to do. So I decided to go and start the online teaching. Luckily, I had my 120-hour TEFL certificate. So Premier TEFL has been very helpful towards everything, every step of the way since 2015. So I must really, really, I'm very grateful for them.
Okay, so I'm Vanessa, and I have been teaching English online for the past 2 years. And I started as a preschool teacher in Portland, Oregon, and then I took a trip to Hong Kong, Seoul, and Japan. And I knew when I got back that I wanted to keep on traveling, so I started looking up how to do that, and I found out about online teaching, and that's where I found out about Premier TEFL. So I got the longer certification, 240 hours, yes, right? It's been a while. And I completed that while getting my early childhood education degree. And my husband also completed it too. And then about 2 months later or so, something like that, we had already been working with a company for about 3 months. So a few months later, we started traveling, and we've been to 22 different countries while traveling online and teaching English, and now we are in Ireland. So yeah.
It's fab. It's fab. I'll never get sick of hearing those stories because it's just so inspirational. You know, it's just like the world is your oyster when you start this journey. It's fantastic. Yes. It really is. Now, both of you, before we get into the teaching online side of things, both of you have had an experience of being a classroom teacher in a physical classroom. So talk to us a little bit about how it differs from teaching online.
Well, sorry, Vanessa.
No, you're right.
Well, I was teaching, I started teaching in the classroom from 2018 till the end of 2019. And I thought that it was going to be, I don't know, I thought I would connect more with the children in the classroom, and it was really a great experience. I had 45 children in the classroom, so that became very tiring for me. And workload, it just kept coming and coming. And you're not getting paid for those extra hours as well. You're working overtime. You're doing extra murals, you have parent meetings, it keeps going on and on and on, and there's always training. I absolutely love teaching children, don't get me wrong, but I think since starting the online teaching from the beginning of this year, I have more flexible time to do a lot more and be working in the comfort of my home. So teaching from the classroom and my bedroom is completely different. I must say, I never look back. I would love to carry on teaching online for a very long time.
Yeah, so I was teaching at a preschool, and I had I could have a maximum of 20 kids to two teachers, but when they come, so they were 3 years old, when they come from the toddler room, it's two teachers for 10 kids. So it's just, there's a big change. There's a lot of personalities to manage. And then when I lost my co-teacher, my students were going to different classrooms, and it was just really chaotic. And there's not, you're not paid that well. You're not very supported by staff. And that's what I also hear from other teachers that teach in the classrooms. So it's really difficult. I had a lot of children that needed individual attention, and I could not give that individual attention. But I really do love the connections you make with the families, and just the hands-on of being with the little kids. It's just so rewarding. Online, I would say that, yeah, you can connect with them, but only so much. You can't get like that closeness, and you can't manage some of those behaviors as easily as you would be able to be in the classroom, because you're not there. And sometimes if the parents aren't there either, then they could just be doing whatever they want, closing the camera or being silly, and it's really hard to just like make that connection. So that's the difference. But I would not look back either. It is rewarding teaching online. You have so much freedom, and there's typically, if you're doing what you're supposed to do, there's no boss that's just telling you to do more things when they're not helping you anyways. So I really like just, yeah, teaching online. It's a lot of pressure, less pressure in that way.
For some of those behavioral issues, I guess that's the main challenge for being an online teacher, is that you don't have the ability to reach in and you know, literally sort of guide your student away from doing something naughty. But if you, and we're talking about young learners here, we know that adults can do this, but if you, like, say that's a challenge for teaching online, like, what are some of the techniques that you would use? And say if somebody was new to teaching English online, and their students were closing the camera or maybe leaving the device to go get a teddy bear or something like that, what's your go-to sort of technique to round that down?
I will definitely, because we have assessments after, so I'll try to write it in the assessment. If the parent could come to class, so that would help. Showing them things that they like I have these Google slides that you can get stars and build something like a superhero or something, but sometimes it's just challenging, especially if the parent doesn't come or the student will just keep doing that. And it's really challenging, but just really trying to engage them and find things that they like is really helpful.
Yes. So the more you know your student, the easier it becomes.
Yes.
Yes, I'd say so. It's the same with every student, in the physical classroom or online. Mm-hmm. And Melissa, do you have any challenges, or how do you overcome some of the challenges from online teaching?
Yeah, exactly what Vanessa says. I mean, it's good to write it in the comments or the memos at the end of the day and make sure that the parents know about it. But again, I mean, 80% of the time the parents actually don't read those memos. Yep. So you kind of know, because you ask them to maybe draw your picture for class next time and show you. And if they didn't show you the picture, you know that they didn't read that memo. They didn't know anything about it. But one of the things that I use a lot of the time is I have like maybe a funny clown nose, just to get them engaged and let them see something that's funny and they will want to look, and they try and cover everything. Or if there is a game that we're playing and they pick a number and that it's a favorite cartoon character, they're like, oh, wow, you know, they're amazed by things that they like. So you got to try and get to know them and what they like and what they don't like. Some kids are like, I don't like that. So then, you know, scratch that out. We're not using that in the next lesson. But a big thing is a musical instrument on my side. If I use a certain new musical instrument, they're like, wow, or any new sounds. It keeps them engaged in my lessons, I must say.
That's brilliant. It sounds like a lot of fun. And you know, there's evidence out that says that learning online can be 5 times more effective than learning in a physical classroom with a bunch of more distractions. Would you say that if we compare your classroom experience to your online teaching experience, would you say that that trend is seen by you as well?
I would say definitely there is a pro and a con to it. The pro at the moment now with lockdown and everything, kids are having this benefit to still continue the learning online and having to adapt to the technology. And there are so many people that are homeschooled and they're able to learn to discipline themselves and keep up with the material. Whereas at school, sometimes kids are all over the place. They get that distraction. They don't have, they're not focused. Whereas in the classroom or at home, you have to learn discipline. I think that's the biggest thing, having to learn discipline and having sure that someone there is, you know, like making sure that they're on key with everything. They learn to develop that maturity level as they grow up, and especially for social skills as well.
And would you say that, you know, in terms of the discipline and the rhythm and routine, because they say routine sets you free, would you ladies have a set structure to your lessons? Or is there a set structure set out by the company that you work for? Or is it completely free that you can pick however you want to spend, say, your 20-minute lesson? Tell me a little bit about the structure.
So for me, we have 30-minute classes, and we don't, at most companies, they have to finish the lesson, but we can go at their own pace. So I just really see how it goes, open up, ask them how they're doing, what they did today, and then just go at their pace, see if they're losing the focus, then I maybe show them something related to lesson, play a game with them on the slides I have, and every time they get a star, they can either have like this or that on here related to the lesson, or would you rather, or like, what are you supposed to wear in certain weathers? And they can pick stuff like that. So just really working with those stars to give them an extra reward is helpful, because sometimes they've been working, even though there's lockdown. Well, not all of our students, or some of them are going back to school. They're going from like 7 a.m. to like 11 p.m. at night, regardless of their age. And that's what they have to do. So just really trying to engage them and finish, see how they're going, to just finish as much as you can. Mm-hmm. And keep it engaging and keep it English based.
And Melissa, do you have a set structure?
Yeah, so I'm working with 3 different companies at the moment. So each one's very different. So especially if you working with many companies, you have to be understanding that every company is different. Some companies you might not get that many classes, and some companies you might. Again, some are very strict with time. So with the first company that I'm working with, I have regular students every week. So I see them twice a week, and I have 6 lessons a day with them, or 6 lessons a day in general. But the structure there, they give you the lesson, you do the intro, you do the lesson plan, and you do songs and all of that. And you give them rewards and stars. They love the rewards as well. That's very encouraging. The parents love, especially I have 2 in the class, and they like to go at it for stars or whatever it is, for trophies. And they absolutely love it in there. With the second company, it's very flexible. I don't see the students as regularly. So you have to kind of get an intro and feel how their English is. And you've got to learn to adapt to if their level is below or or advanced. So you've got to kind of play and be prepared as well. So over preparing is the best thing to do in case that doesn't work out, and now you've got another 40 minutes to go along with the lesson, because some lesson plans, they will give you 2 pages and you've got to do the reading, and you've just got to make it up and go along with it. So different companies are very different with different materials and stuff like that. And then the last company that I'm working with is very similar to my first company, where it's structured. I have regular students as well.
It's cool. And do they give you lesson activities, or is it just the lesson plan? So if somebody was new to teaching English online and they joined a platform, they might get a lesson outline to follow, but they've got to put in the activities and flesh it all out so it makes up all the time.
Yeah, I get lesson plans, and the second company that I'm working for is they help you with training. So if you want to learn training for group classes, which I currently did, I teach 12 in a class now currently, and we have the co-teacher there who will help me as well. So it's really nice because I'm not alone in the classroom. So they do give you the lesson material, but it is good that you kind of engage and interact with games. They might not give you the games, so you need to think out the box and make sure that you interact with a game or an activity that maybe you have, or a song. They don't initially give you songs, maybe some places, I know, but that's just my experience.
It's so interesting that you have 12 in the group now, isn't it? And what sort of age range are those learners?
They can range from between 4 to 16 years old. I mean, I have a group that I teach regularly, like 7 or 8, and they're about 4 or 5 years old in the class. Okay. And the co-teacher will actually help and mute students and help you. So she kind of navigates, and I'll say, do you mind just giving rewards while I'm busy with all my teaching materials? And she'll reward them if they did good and unmute them and mute them. Because the thing is, like, especially with little kids, you can't keep them all quiet the whole time. So they have to learn to know when their name's being called, and then they're like, oh, it's my turn. And it's really fun. With the older kids, it's a lot easier because you can keep it, you don't have to mute them. And their reading is really fun to do because they actually like do dialogues together, and you bring them down and they talk to each other, and they like to fight for rewards as well. It's really fun there.
What about for you, Vanessa?
Yeah, so I would say, yeah, some of the similar things. It's just we have it where, so I only have to teach one, but yeah, that sounds very interesting how there's 10 in a class like that. Yeah, so for us, it's pretty, like we said, structured, but just really engaging them and finding those rewards for them is really important. And the one-on-one is really helpful. They give you the lesson plan, but you definitely have to be more interactive than that plan, because it's just slides. And some of the slides sometimes can often just seem like they were from some of the books that they have. Mm-hmm. So that could be not as engaging to them. So just having songs, making up just songs that have to do with the lessons, or just really finding your own games that go with the lesson, really is beneficial too.
And I think for something, you have 2 years under your belt now from doing this. So for a new person joining into the online teaching world, those lesson plans could be quite valuable for them, but just that they know they need to inject the dynamic activity, because otherwise you just won't hold the attention of the students.
No, yeah, even younger or older, because the older students, they have a lot of other stuff they want to do, or do homework that they have to do, or, you know, it's 30 minutes, so they could be wanting to do something else. So even at the older level, you have to really find ways to even engage those levels and just find what works best for your student. Yeah. But yeah, the plans are very helpful.
And say, on top of the plans, what kind of preparation would you do for a set of classes, or for one class even as an example? So if you know, we know you've got 2 years of experience, and we know then you're teaching the younger learners mostly one-on-one, and you have plans from your employer, which is all great, but prior to doing your lessons, do you do a certain amount of prep work to get yourself ready for the day?
Well, once you start teaching, I feel like you start remembering a lot of the lessons, so you know what's going to come up. So just like recently, what I've been doing is really getting, figuring out what Google slides I want to use based on what we're going to be doing. So if it's like, If it's like a clothing lesson or a summer lesson, I have one for that. So just figuring out what students I'm going to do for which, and then also finding out like what students like. If it's not one that's maybe like a story that you don't really have to, there's not really something that'll probably go with it, but like, I don't know.
And do you make your own Google slides?
Yeah, I do. So like, what do you want to wear in winter? And then, or which do you wear in winter? Do you wear, I don't know, shorts or whatever? Yes, I do all my own little Google slides. These are just ones where like you have to pretend to guess, and obviously I can't draw, so it's pretty funny. And then like you go, and then what's that? Who knows? And that, and then it's like a unicorn, and then it says it's a unicorn, so you like have to repeat it and stuff like that. So, just stuff like that, really.
I mean, it's, you say it like it's simple, but this stuff is so cool for people who are just starting out. You know, you guys both have all of these really neat tricks for keeping the engagement high in the classroom. And, you know, when people and the folks at home are looking at this, they're going to be scribbling down all these ideas and they'll be putting them into your own classrooms. I've no doubt about it.
Yeah, I got these ideas about the Google Slides from a lot of other teachers. So being on Instagram and having other teachers, you find a lot of things, especially some of the other companies. They have a lot of really interesting reward things that the teachers use. So just also, that's a really good way to get ideas as well.
And for your companies, do you have social network groups? Like, can you join a Facebook group or a forum or something for other teachers from your own company?
I would say for mine, people don't really use it, and if they do, they may be not using it the proper way. Mm-hmm. Like how I follow people that are from VIP Kids, that's a lot of the teachers I've been following, even though I don't work for them. So I don't think that they really use it for my company that well.
Okay, but there's lots of teachers out there that,
yeah,
I mean, between YouTube and Instagram and Pinterest, there are so many resource ideas.
Oh, yeah, totally. There's so many resources, so many teachers out there that have specific, like, teacher profiles. Like I said, a lot of VIP Kids teachers do it. And so you just learn so many ideas, and they have a lot of them, especially if you live in the United States. They have, like, where they buy the rewards from these Etsy shops and stuff, and some of the teachers have shirts they make. So it's really cool to just see all that. It gets you really inspired, and
yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, and I have a support group on WhatsApp and all that, South African group with my companies, and we always like, have you been paid yet? Oh, what's going on here?
Oh, yeah.
It's also because like sometimes I must say you have to be very careful, because some companies, they short pay you, mm-hmm. and you want to know what happened there. They won't tell you. So you have to always make sure and check the rules here. What was that? Why did that cancel? So it's very nice to have that support group as well. Mm-hmm. I've joined on Facebook groups, and it's been very, very helpful, as well as teachers like to like mention, oh, okay, any teachers would like to try out this company, they're looking for teachers. So it's good to get in there with the group as well, because it can benefit you finding other sideline jobs as well.
Definitely. Yeah.
And would you find, we'll say your online teaching career is about 6 months at the minute, Melissa, would you say that you need to do a bit more prep work before heading into a day of teaching? Or like what Vanessa was saying, once you get into the rhythm, and you get a few months or more under your belt, you start to have that muscle memory where you know what's coming up in the lesson, and you could go right into all the aspects of it.
Yeah, I must say, once you get into the rhythm of it, it does become a lot easier. But myself, I'm over-organized, so I think I always go to the extreme. Like I think I have my co-teachers and everything, they're like, oh wow, Melissa, you really prepare yourself, you know, don't overwork yourself too much, because I will plan a slideshow for 2 hours literally just to make sure that I'm prepared for anything that happens. But again, some companies are very easygoing, as long as that you keep a flow and you keep it structured, and at the end of the day that they've learned what was given to them, the review material, whatever it was, the objective of the lesson. But But yeah, I mean, I over-prepare my things a little bit more. So I would say even from the beginning, when I first started teaching online at the beginning, I was so nervous. And I have so many friends at the moment. They're very nervous to start the online teaching world. And I was there in the same boat. And the thing is, like, as soon as you start getting in, a week goes and another week goes, and you're feeling more confident and you know how the intro, the middle and the ending needs to be always, mm-hmm. is always the same. It's just the lesson material changes, and maybe your games change just a little bit, songs, and maybe changing the reward chart a little bit here and there. Background, maybe you can change the background here and there again, but yeah, I think it's pretty simple, the same thing. I just like to change it up a little bit more than totally. I should.
Vanessa was saying how she loves the Google Slides. What kind of resources do you use in your classroom?
With regards to props or just rewards?
Well, let's go props and then we can talk about rewards after.
Okay, so the props that I have currently, one of my favorite things is I cannot sing. But this tool is amazing because once I start singing and then I show them that they need to sing. So it's a kind of a useful tool that's their turn to talk. And my musical instrument is always, I always use my harmonica to either stop the noise and go, okay, and then I blow it. And or it's time for rewards and I'll blow it and we'll just make a noise. You can make binoculars with two toilet rolls, which is really useful. So, I can see. Another thing with learning about my body, we can use minion eyes. We can make it fun, interesting. And I love dressing up for my classes. I make sure I'm either a pirate or Minnie Mouse or whoever I want to be in the class that day. So those are very useful as well, and making sure you have a lot of flashcards. I always, always print flashcards for my lessons, or I use Manicam, which has the pictures that you can use there on the platform as well. So those are just a couple of my props.
The Manicam, you can change your background. It's like a kind of a green screen effect, isn't that right?
Yeah. So you can actually, I want to get the green screen for the background here, and you can actually change it. You in the classroom, you're on the beach or wherever, but you know, I was temporarily going to be here in South Africa for a short time and go and travel. But now with the lockdown, I don't want to buy too many things. So the Manicam is really useful because you can make borders around your screen here. And you can also do the reward system on your screen as well. So you can do an ice cream and add on to the ice cream and it gets bigger. Or you can have whatever the theme is. If it's the ocean, you can have a fish bowl and you add fish on, and you can let them challenge each other for more rewards. There you can put, I think you can put videos as well. I haven't tried it back yet.
Yeah, you can.
And there's some like cool little stars that move around and it keeps them engaged as well. But often you don't want to use it too much, otherwise they get too bored of it. But so changing it up is very good.
Very good. You just always have to have your finger on the pulse of the class and read the students, don't you?
Yeah.
And it's harder because, you know, you can see them visually, but you can't pick up some of those extra little nuances that you would if you were with them. So you've just got to work a little bit harder when you're doing the online teacher role. And Melissa, I'm putting your two names together. I'm going to make one favorite person. But Melissa was saying about flashcards, and I've seen you use Uno cards before. Do you want to talk us through how you use those?
Yeah, so if it's for colors, I can ask them what color is whatever's on the screen, or what color if they're wearing something. These are just like the numbers. So when they're counting, I can show them visual, or if they don't know how old they are, if it's a trial student. So yeah, that's how I just use the Uno cards, and for the colors as well. And some of them know the game, so they get really excited. They're like, oh, I know that game. I have that game. I'm like, oh, wow.
And I have doppel at home, and it's called something else in the States, but it's round cards and it has different images on it, and they're usually all different sizes. You can use it like a snap game, but you could also use that essentially as a flashcard and get people to identify what can they see and what colors are there. There's just like, if you're creative, then opportunities are endless, right?
Totally, yes.
Yeah, it's so cool. I love it. And in terms of, say, so I see you with the tablet, okay, and then that's additional technology in the classroom, right? Is there any other technology that you would use in addition to sitting, you know, and having your screen on, you're using the tablet? Is there any other pieces of technology you need to use or is useful?
Not really, but sometimes, like I have an older student, and sometimes I know the stuff he likes to see, and I have like the Chinese Twitter, so like they post things on there, so sometimes I'll see things and I want to show him about, if it's basketball, they post really cool things about like this kids playing sports and stuff, so sometimes like that, and I'll show him like a little short video from that, or I'll be like, did you see this, or something like that. And then sometimes if the kids, little ones, if they like Paw Patrols, I'll be like, okay, if we get through this, we could watch like few seconds of Paw Patrols or something like that. So yeah, that's just how I use it sometimes.
And would you just use that YouTube on your
YouTube on my tablet, or if I'm using my tablet then for like the rewards, maybe I'll do it on my phone.
And we talk so much about rewards all through this chat today. So how do you give a reward to somebody that you're not in the same room as? Like, how does that work?
So a lot of people have asked me, like, how do kids like really like get the rewards? I mean, and I show them things and they're like, how is that rewarding? But it really is encouraging. So I have this, this is especially for the younger kids. I've made it out of a box, or old box recycle, and you have a spinning top. And wow, it spins, and a lot of them like Spider-Man or Superman, and then they get to whatever it comes on, and they're like, oh, Spider-Man, yeah, and they get each have a turn on that. Another one that I have is the numbers, and they choose a number, and then whatever is hidden behind it, it's either a star or whatever, so it helps them for the counting. And I have I'll have like four or five jars, and they'll either get a smiley face, and they actually like to pull the faces, which face they like, if it's a tongue face, and then I actually stick it on whichever one that they like. So, but I'm trying to like think a little bit more out the box, because sometimes they get bored after a week or two seeing the same reward system. So it's always good to change it up, especially if you have the same student over again. So you have to change up the lesson a lot.
Yeah. And continue to keep building that teacher toolkit. And say for your backgrounds, I've seen a few of yours, Vanessa, that are so cool. And I think I've seen this one before for you, Melissa, too. How much work goes into these backgrounds?
I must say that my background, I mean, I really put it, I like the creative artsy side. So I've only made this. This is my first background for this year that I've made. And the brighter that is, and if you have white to pop out the colors, it makes it a lot visual on the screen here as well. Because I also noticed I was wearing black and it didn't pop out my colors. It would like kind of contrast everything. So the more bright whites and colors that you bring out in your poster, the more it's going to pop out as well. I try to minimize my things. I actually haven't got it stuck on the wall, just because we're not allowed to stick things on the wall here. So I actually have it on a mirror. So I've stuck mine on a mirror, and I'm literally sitting next to the side of my bed. I'm sitting on my side table here, literally. I don't have a chair, and it's a small little table here. And again, you can move around with your posters and stick it on wherever you are around the world, which makes it so easy as well. And that's the best thing about it, that you can just pack up your little classroom and off you go. Yeah.
You're just waiting for the days that the airport reopens.
Oh, I know. I know, totally.
And this looks really comprehensive, Vanessa, behind you. What is it?
Oh, it's just a curtain. It's like a curtain off Amazon. Yeah. And they have actually a lot of these different curtains or like shower curtain things, but this is like a regular curtain or maybe a tablecloth. You can just put in like tapestry, educational tapestry, and they have it on there. And yeah, so it's just the continents with the animals. And also it rolls up really small to travel. And it's on right now with clothespins and command strips, but I've never used command strips to take them off. So we'll see how that goes, because I'm also probably not supposed to have anything on the wall, but I usually use like how she does it on the mirror, but we'll see. I've heard people use command strips safely, so we'll see.
So command strips say that they are supposed to come off with no markings. They just do this.
That's
little
what they click. Say if you do it slow, we'll yeah. see.
Yeah, we will. Oh. And that's fantastic. I think for people that are watching this now, if they're not excited to teach online, then they're definitely in the wrong webinar. I am buzzed to go get myself some students online. If I was going to start out tomorrow teaching English, tell me about the really important pieces that I need. So I know I need a laptop or a high spec tablet, but what are the main things? We need a tablet or a device. We need a headset, a microphone, really strong internet. Talk me through some of the detail of that, just so that people at home can know whether they could transition into an online classroom without making drastic changes to the devices they own. Who's gonna go?
Yeah, I would say that as long as you have, like you said, the internet, the computer, maybe good lighting, like the selfie light that I have, which didn't really help, but like this. A lot of people have kids, so I'm sure they have little puppets and props and stuff. So it's, you don't really need too much once you have that. I mean, like even the, while a lot of people do have full headsets, these are just really good earbuds and they work just fine. And I've never had complaints about them. So I know the Apple ones work really good too. So most people have that already. So I feel like you don't need too much.
Need too much. There's not that much investment to get going. No. And like your sound is perfect, and it's so clear, and the picture on your laptop is so clear. Is it an expensive one or is it mid-range?
I don't think this was expensive. I got it in Thailand, I think, because my laptop broke before I had a MacBook. But this is just an Acer Swift 3, and no, it wasn't too expensive. But I think most laptops, most computers should be just fine.
Mm-hmm. And then internet speed, I know you like super high speed for your internet. Is it 20 up and down?
I like 20 up and down. But if you can go lower, probably like even, I don't know, like 5, and then 5 download and maybe 3 upload. And especially if you're connected to the Ethernet cable, it's going to be more consistent. So it should be okay.
And Melissa, would you know your internet speed, or would you go and say, go to Google and just check speed test?
Yeah, a lot of the companies, they like you to send what your speed is. A lot of them have asked me to be 20 up. But some are, I've seen my lowest have been like about 10. But the biggest thing is for those beginners online teaching, I think, a lot of them are like, I don't have a degree. What, I can't teach online. And I know people are like very against people teaching without a degree and everything, but the TEFL certificate helps you through that as well. So the biggest thing is just to get through that TEFL certificate. And a lot of people are like, oh, well, you know, it's going to take me a long time. I think the sooner you start doing it, the sooner we're going to get going, because the longer you keep waiting, the longer it's going to be a chance for you to get students and the students to get to know you. The more you get noticed, the more the teachers want you, the more the students want you. It took me, I started at the beginning of the year, only end of March, where my class is only starting to fill up, because people started noticing me and my classes started to fill up. So it does also, I'd say, patience mm-hmm. is a big thing. So, and make sure that you have a little bit of capital to know that your first and your second month, you're not going to make that high salary that everyone's saying you're going to make. Probably the third or the fourth month is going to be a good month that we're going to get some good students and they're going to be regular students. Mm-hmm. So my biggest thing is patience, because a lot of people say they want to teach online, but they want to do it like now. But it is a process. So they just have to be patient. The process will work if they just wait.
That's great advice. That's sound advice, because essentially, while there are a few conversational companies out there that will hire you without having a TEFL certification, if you're maybe native English speaker with a degree, something like that, you won't be equipped with the techniques and the skills of how to teach English through complete language submersion. There is a knack to this, you know. If you get your certification, you will have the secret, you know, of how to do this effectively and not be in the classroom struggling and, you know, struggling to teach the four skills and to understand your role as a teacher and how do I assess the motivation or the level of my student. Mm-hmm. So you're right, the TEFL certification is the first step on this journey. And I think it's also true, you know, you can't just emerge with a TEFL certificate and then suddenly be fully booked as a teacher. You do need to build up a reputation. Mm-hmm. And, you know, and essentially have your students rate you and things like that. So those are two excellent tips. And of course, you know, the laptop and the headset and all that goes with it. But mm-hmm. you need to have yourself the TEFL certification, get yourself out the starting blocks. And 100%. And in terms of the degree, it is important for people to know that if you want to work for a Chinese-owned platform, then the new regulations for 2020 would say that you do need to have a degree. It's the same as if you wanted to go to China and physically teach there. But there's a whole bunch of platforms out there that are not Chinese-owned, that are owned by Europeans or in the US. And so there's a lot of variation in terms of the requirements to get going. We even have a little quiz on premiertefl.com where you can find out on the resources page mm-hmm. which platform is a match for your profile. So you can punch in, yeah, what country you're from, what your qualifications are, if you've got any experience, and then literally in like less than 30 seconds, it'll give you a list of companies that match your profile. So that's easy.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah. Wow.
I need that. I need to go try that to see where else I can go.
Yeah, me too, totally.
And I think then when people are looking for online platforms, there's such a breadth of choice. Look at what your profile is and look at companies that match that. Instead of going out all sort of guns blazing and applying everywhere and anywhere, be careful, read up what employers are a match for you before you waste your time applying to places that just physically can't hire you. You know, you don't meet the criteria to be hired. So you've got to work within your own sort of, I suppose, background pool. And then when you get experience, then you can move on to different platforms. And I think there's a great entry level opportunity and then you can scale up, right? I mean, there's lots of opportunities.
Yeah, definitely.
And so, ladies, it's been a pleasure as always. I could stay talking to you guys all day about teaching English online. Before we go, do you want to leave our audience with, say, one last top tip or one piece of advice or something if people are on the fence and they're not sure if this is for them? What recommendation would you give? It's a tough one now.
I think that my recommendation would just be to try it, especially now. You're at home, you could get started, whether if you didn't think you could do it before because you couldn't finish the certification or you weren't gonna have enough time. Now you have the time and now you can do it. And if you're patient and you will get students, you will meet a lot of great kids or adults, and it's really worth it. It's really rewarding and there is a space for everyone and it's a great opportunity.
Yeah, I think that, I mean, What is everyone waiting for? This is an opportunity for so many people. And I mean, the world is your oyster. You can take this anywhere with you. You can go and travel with your family with it. Now that everyone's in lockdown and having so much limitations at the moment, this is the time to start doing it. I mean, whether it's your premier TEFL course or whatever it is, get started now, because if you're not enjoying your job outside there, you might as well start somewhere inside at home.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And you can change lives from the edge of your bedroom, right?
Mm-hmm.
Change and connect lives and improve people's prospects. All these kids that are learning from you guys and the older people too. And teaching online isn't just for kids. I know we focused on it a little bit today, but you can teach up to any kind of corporate. You could be teaching a CEO. And it's because English is the business and the key language of the world. So if you can speak English, then your future is bright. You know, you might as well do a job you deserve. Do a job that's going to make you happy. Absolutely. 100% agree. Absolutely, ladies. Thank you so much for joining me today.
Yay.
And I hope that we will return as well in a brand new live series. So stay tuned for that on premiertefl.com. And for anyone who's enjoying the webinar experience, we've also recently launched our new live TEFL webinar classes. So join us in a virtual TEFL classroom from anywhere around the world for live TEFL training. And there's more information on the website about that too. Now, before we go, I promise, as always, there's a free gift for everybody who joins us. And we've already done the Teaching English Online free gift, and that was in webinar one. So today we're going to do a free 30-hour Teaching Business English gift. And so anybody can go to the website and find our Teaching Business English course and go ahead and enter the code TEACHBUSINESS. And you will receive that as a free gift for joining us today and listening to our chats and enjoying it, I hope, as much as we did. So thank you so much, everyone. Thank you, ladies. And we will see you next time. Join us at premiertefl.com for more of these webinars.